morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for day three of Digital Design Week. I'm really excited about today because we have an action-packed day. So we start with Rajshree Patti, who is the founder of India Design Forum. So if you've been to any Hyderabad Design Week, Bangalore Design Week, India Design Forum in Bombay, the India Design Forum at Make in India, all of these have been spearheaded by her. And then second up in the afternoon, we have a webinar by Rahul Shankwalker, who is the partner at Studio HBA, which is a global design firm. And he's going to be talking about barefoot luxury. He's going to be doing a presentation about it. So definitely don't miss that. That's going to be on Zoom and it's a webinar. And lastly, we have Stefano Giovanni of Kibu, who is going to be talking about his unforgettable designs, his iconic pieces, and that's something also I recommend you don't miss. So today is going to be a really fun day, so try staying looped in for everything that's happening. And I'm going to start with a little bit more about Rajshree. So Rajshree is the founder behind India Design Forum, as I said earlier, and they've been doing this for around 10 odd years. And Rajshree was given, and I'm going to read this off so I don't get it wrong, because she's done some amazing work in the space. So Rajshree has received an honorary doctorate last year by the Ajinkya DY Institute of Innovation, Pune, for her contribution to design. She was also honored with the Padma Shri in 2014 for her contribution to industry and trade. So the amount she has given selflessly to the community, to the industry, something I've always admired about her. And we're going to talk to her today about putting India on the map globally in terms of design. We're going to talk about the London Design Biennale, where India had a pavilion, which was again spearheaded by her. And we're going to talk about education in the system. So let's get Rajshree in. Just give me a second and I'm going to add her into the conversation. All right. Give me a second. She's just going to come in. And please tell us how you've been enjoying the design week. We end day after, so Friday is the last day. I'd love to hear from everyone about how... Hi, Rajshree. Good morning.
Hi, Isha. Good to be back on Design Pataki. I haven't seen you in a couple of years. Great to be here. Hello, everybody. It's a nice, sunny, very hot morning in Coimbatore. Where I am right now, isolating.
Oh, I know.
Hope you're all safe.
And you're under curfew, so it's pretty, it's a lot more stricter down in Coimbatore than it is in Bombay.
Yes. We are totally under curfew. But I'm keeping sane and safe, doing lots of things with ITF, delighted with all the work that Design Pataki is doing to keep the design community engaged.
I mean, we have to do something, and thank you so much for supporting. I think, you know, I've always told you to admire how you've pioneered design, especially you've always been ahead of your times, and that's something I'm going to talk to you about, is especially with IDF. I remember in 2013, and when they say 2013, I can't believe it's been 7 years. You know, India Design Forum in Bombay, and your lineup, and I'm just, before you start talking about it, I'm going to tell everyone the lineup today, because back then those names were probably not as well known as they are today. And you were ahead of your times once again. So you had Thomas Heatherwick, you had Christian Louboutin, you had Sabi Sarchi, you had Oscar Zieta, you had Anushka Hempel, and this is all from memory. I have not seen a list, nothing has been sent to me. You had Rahul Mehrotra. I cannot even begin to start about what a lineup you had. You had Suman Jayakrishnan, and all these names are etched in my memory because of those conversations. That is unbelievable. So, Rajshree, please tell us what made you do it, how you did it. Tell us about the whole experience.
Well, actually, I've always been interested in design. I think I owe a lot to my mother. And it's incredible how her journey was, because she grew up in a small town near Coimbatore all those years. And then when she moved and built her house in the 60s, she actually had an architect called Valentine Gunasekara, who was a modernist from Sri Lanka. And I remember growing up in a house that had, you know, glass cubes, glass bricks, the Corbusier chaise longue, the Ettore Sozza's mirrors, the Mies van der Rohe, the Eero Saarinen's boom chair. So I grew up with these things, and I had no idea then about all of this, you know. And it's only later when I realized that these were really design pieces. My mother and father passed away quite tragically when we were, you know, in our 30s. And I never really got time to ask her where she got these influences from. But obviously, Valentine Gunasekara brought in those influences. And I must understand that this was in the 60s. And in the 60s, very few people in India actually understood modernism. Right. Understood our house movement. Yeah. And I remember thinking how different my house looks from other homes. And I loved it because it had that industrial feel. Yeah. And therefore, I carried this along with me throughout. And I always wanted to study architecture. And my parents declined to send me to America. They said I'd go to America and get married to an American and never come back to Coimbatore. And two daughters, they just wouldn't send me out. Anyway, all for the good. If I had, perhaps idea wouldn't have happened. And so, through the journey of life, I decided at some point I really needed to address these passions that were so inherent in me, and I needed to do something macro, you know. So I felt a strong need to create something that would work holistically with design, address comprehensive issues, and the need to work with government and with people who actually make the policy papers, and to work with educational institutions, with practicing architects, designers, to actually bring an awareness to design thinking.
Right.
IDF really is about design thinking.
That's where I think, you know, India Design Forum is different, is because you've always worked with the government, and that's, you know, we all know how hard that is. Every other design institution, you know, whether it's a media house or a publishing house, they do it all on their own. You've managed to create that syndication and get them involved, which again is so important.
Look, you know, in a country as large as India and as diverse as India,
right,
it's not adequate for small pockets of private initiatives. Right. If we want to make a difference and we want to bring design to the forefront of policy and planning, and make it really quantitatively and qualitatively interesting, and to create change, we need to work with government. And my years of experience of heading, in several positions in the Confederation of Indian Industry and in my own industry that is very driven by policy, I saw what policy can do. And which is why I've always been inclusive. At India Design Forum, we've been inclusive. We always work with institutions and with government.
Right. Because that's how you get, like you said, that's how we reach that the larger scale that we're looking at, because otherwise it will always be very private and it'll always be very small.
Isha, you know, it's, I can tell you, you know, how it's made a difference. We did the first India Design Forum in Delhi in 2013. And even then, we had Paola Antonelli, we had Kareem Rashid, we had Lee Edelcourt. We had amazing, amazing speakers. And I invited several of the ministers actually to speak at the forum on urban development. what are we thinking about, cleaning the nallas of Delhi. We brought in architects to actually speak. We brought in Chandigarh, and we did a whole session called the Chandigarh Experiment, because Chandigarh stands out as a unique experiment in India. And so we had two groups of people debating about it. What is it we like? What is it we don't like? Can this model be replicated? So you see, government comes into all of this. Secondly, where it made a difference was also for Chakravyuh. When the inaugural design biennale was happening, the directors of the biennale wrote to the Ministry of Culture. They wrote to
the inaugural London Design Biennale,
and so that was in 2016, and they didn't get any response. And because we were connected with the whole London design fraternity, they wrote to me and said, can you speak to the government, because it would be a shame if a country like India, which has such a strong trade relationship with Great Britain, does not participate in an important inaugural biennale. And so I took it up upon IDF to do this. And we went to the Ministry of Industry and Commerce, which controls design in India. It's unlike the Ministry of Culture in most other countries.
Right.
And design was grossly misunderstood. They said, so is this a trade exhibition? Because the idea of a biennale didn't strike the government. They said, this is a trade exhibition. Can we get our craftsmen there? Can we sell our wares? Can we take up all of these things? I said, I'm sorry, this is a biennale. And so what difference does it make to the country? How does it bring any value to the country? I said, look, we have to showcase India there. And a biennale is about building relationships, about building bridges. We bring in so much focus on a country.
Right.
And India is a globalizing, modern, one of the fastest growing economies in the world. And we have to showcase that. It took a long time to understand for them, but they said, okay, we'll sanction you, entry.
Right.
To the inaugural London Design Biennale, and it has to be an India entry. Now, it took me a long time to get that, but we did get it. And I must tell you all that participation has been the very first official endorsement of any kind of India entry into any international biennale.
Wow.
And we had the stamp of the Ministry of Industry and Commerce, the Department of Industrial Policy and Trade Promotion. And I think to me, that was the victory. I mean, apart from the fact that it was the most written about and the largest
standing. Yeah, it was gorgeous. And I can imagine the whole, like you told me yesterday, you had the press flooded when they saw the pictures of it. Doing everything.
Yes. And we brought out a book, and I'm sure many of you can see it on.
I also have the pictures which I'm going to pull up from Chakravyuh, because we wanted to showcase it. So do you want to talk about your equation with Sumant as well, who created the
book? I want to talk to you about Sumant, and this was part of the graphic design that went into it.
Right.
And so what we did was, the team was given to us, and the team was, Utopia by Design. Come on, guys, this is a very abstract theme. How do we then actually translate this into a design installation, Utopia by Design? So I was brainstorming, and I said, India lives on multiple utopias.
Right.
For someone in India, a meal is a utopia. A meal for a day is a utopia. Somebody else, it's educating their children in a good school is utopia. For some people, a private jet is utopia. India lives and works and coexistence of multiple utopias. So, I've always been a student of Vedanta, and the idea of Chakravyuha was very important and embedded in my mind, because life is about, you know, maneuvering the maze. And then I said to myself, let's call it Chakravyuha. So I went to Sumant, and Sumant has been a friend, and I've admired his greatly his sensibilities of design and color and the whole Indian vibrancy, you know. And right. Sumant is absolutely brilliant at putting that together. So I went to Sumant and he said, but you know, it's only you've given me 2 months. I said, Sumant, I know. I said, I had to work very hard to muster up some money to get the sponsorship. And I said, I said, we can do it. And I said, this is my idea for representing this design by Utopia. Let's call it Chakravyuha. Then we decided we call it Chakravyu because it's easier. And, you know, it's easier for people to understand. And it says what it needs to say.
Right.
So Sumant was absolutely brilliant. He brought in graphic design, he brought in audio visual technology, and you know, we created something that I think even now the London Design Biennale is promoting it on their social media. And you know, we had wonderful people to support it. We had, I mean, apart from the government and CII was with me in supporting this, because CII has a design committee and I've chaired it in earlier times. And Aditya Birla gave us their textiles, Serendipity, and Deepika Jindal of Jindal, provided us with this amazing mirror finished, stainless steel flooring that was magical. But more than anything else, I mean, the Biennale established for India that we're a modern, globalizing economy with a great contemporary design aesthetic, and that's what I wanted to establish.
And that's what you did. I think you did, both of you, Sumant, and you did a phenomenal job. When I saw those pictures come to me, I was like, wow, it literally, and this is in London, so I, you know, to execute this in London, like you've spoken about the challenges that you faced as well over there. But let's talk about these pictures as well, Rachi. I'm going to pick up, pulling out a few so people can have a look. And this is the flooring you're talking about, which is a reflection of the ceiling, if I'm not mistaken.
And that is a reflection of the ceiling, yes. And those are the 6 chakras. And the inside is a room called like a womb, and that is the 7th chakras, depicting the 7 chakras. And the floor, as you walk in through the floor, you stand and you're enveloped by all this vibrancy and the cacophony of audio, you know, of Mahatma Gandhi, Pandit Nehru, of Kukul Jayaka, of a street in India. And you know, the walls that you see on both sides, which are those old embroidery wooden loops with all the graphic fonts, which were by Hanif Qureshi and Rukhwa, his wife. And this is the photography they'd done, and they transferred it on silk screen onto these loops. So basically, this is to show India's multiple utopias, because we believe in salvation. We believe in karma. We believe in progress. So in a contemporary expression, the chakras really are ascending, you know.
Right.
We ascend into a modern global economy, and it comes from the fundamentals of Charles and Ray Eames, the whole theory, when they came down, were invited to set up the National Design Policy and set up NID. We took it from those narrations, how important design is. And for India, it's, you know, the significance of the mud lota that everyone drinks from, you know, that's in a way symbolic of Indian design. And your thali, which could be, a mud thali, it could be a leaf thali, it can be a stainless steel thali, it can be a silver thali, it can be a gold, diamond encrusted thali. But this is India's multiple utopia,
right? It's a thali, yeah.
Yeah. So, and the film inside was really all about the progress from then to selling off India's own indigenous spacecraft on the Mars mission, which was done at a fraction of a cost compared to the other countries. Just to say that India's ingenuity, India's creativity, India's innovative spirit far surpasses most others. And we are a great country with great creativity. But we need to progress in that. We need to create an awareness and continue to work for our designers, for innovation, and to make our designers exposed, to make them think.
No, I agree with you, Rajni. I'm going to get away from these pictures because... Just one second. How do I... Yeah. All right. So, you know, Rajni, that's where we come, where, you know, an important part of our discussion this whole week has been, is the community and the industry being fragmented, and how do we bring them together? How do we bring everyone together? And the two aspects we want to talk about today, one is education, of course, and the second one being, how do we, like you've been working with the government, how do we do it as a body? How do we do it as a unified body? I mean, we spoke about a few councils, but I don't think there still is an answer to that, and that's what something we want to touch upon today.
Okay, so India, by virtue of its population, we are pathetically deficient in design skills. I mean, all these decades post-independent India had only NID.
Exactly.
And you have to understand that, you know, post-independent India did not focus on design. It was put on the back burner. It was a modern nation and they wanted only engineers, doctors, scientists, and design was not a priority. It should have been, because nations are built on creativity. Nations are built on innovation. Nations are built on technology. And even technology came into India just maybe, with the globalization.
Yeah.
Not before. But nevertheless, then you saw small independent private schools, like, you know, you had, Srishti in Bangalore, we have one in Coimbatore, the DJ Academy, we have a few in Delhi, we have a few others. But really speaking, we can have 1,000 schools. I mean, look at what China has done. China has schools, design schools, art schools, all of it in every province, and they have thousands of schools. And it's very important, once again, that this comes under the policy. Now,
that's my point, because I feel like there's no agenda. There are no, suppose one school is teaching one aspect of design. I feel like there are a lot of aspects getting lost. There are a lot of subjects not being taught in certain schools. And I'm going to let you complete on that before I butted in.
Okay, so we come to another issue here. You know, there has to be a demand for designers. And there was no demand for designers.
Right.
People went to design school and art school as a time pass. Until now, the very idea of design or art, for that matter, will they get a job? What is my child going to do? Or even for the person who's studying, I mean, where do I go? What kind of salaries do I get? I mean, if a person does, you know, an IT course, and even if they sit and just, you know, punch in numbers from morning till night, you know, there's a salary that's assured at the end of the day. But as a designer, who is absorbing them? Things have changed. I'm happy to say that things have changed in India. The automotive industry and the film industry is a huge, huge place for design designers, for a huge place that consumes designers. Although, even now, a bulk of the design work for the automotive industry in India is produced outside of India. And I've taken it up with the Ministry of Industry and Commerce, saying, if only we focused on Indian designers, you know, or Indian design schools, we would be able to replace so much of foreign exchange that India is exporting for talent and creativity when we have all of it with us.
True.
You know, and we can save on it. And I've spoken to many industries as well. I said, why are you not looking at taking people, recruiting people from Indian design schools?
Right.
You know, so there comes the need to have more design schools to make industry aware that Indian designers are absolutely competent to handle these jobs. Now we have to have good faculty. Faculty training is important. So at IDF, the reason we get these big names is because they've gone way ahead in their design thinking, way ahead in the application of their design resources.
Right.
So therefore, these design minds speaking at IDF to the design community in India hopefully opens out the mind and brings in partnerships. Many partnerships have happened through IDF. You know, we are a non-profit. We work only through sponsorships and we get nothing out of it. I just want to clarify, except the pure satisfaction and the fulfillment that we have made a difference in India. And so therefore, you know, the India Design Council is very closely associated with IDC as well. The couple of good things that that has done, the India Design Council has done, is to institute the India Design Mark, which is like your mark of approval for a good product.
Right.
So I was instrumental in, I'm very involved in handling two of the India Design Mark exhibitions. And I must say, you know, companies that are producing, you know, utilitarian products and even your air conditioners, your heaters, your, you know, your toasters, your fans, your furniture, and all of this participate. And we have an independent jury and some international jury that's invited to actually judge these products and award an India Design Mark. Many, many industries have received the India Design Mark. And some of the very small entrepreneurs have also received the India Design Mark. So with this, they get private equity exposure, other larger companies, you know, partner with them and so on. So this is one of the projects that the India Design Council has done quite successfully.
But Rajshri, surprisingly, this is the first time I'm hearing about the India Design Mark. So, and that should be something that if somebody looks at, they should be happy that they bought something which is a product which has been acknowledged. So I'm surprised that there's not that much awareness about that.
Well, I'm really sorry to hear this, and we'll do something about this. I'm going to say this, you know, Isha, I'm going to say this, that, and I've always said that has to be done in a different way. In fact, I've said that, you know, allow us as IDF to actually add more value to the way IDC is doing it. Also, what India Design Council has done is they've now started a design education quality kind of a mark. Let's put it as an India Design Education Quality Mark. So they will be actually grading design institutions for their quality of faculty, quality of teaching, quality of courses. But that's a good thing. And they've also instituted something called the Chartered Design of India. I'm not very clear what that is. But as far as we are concerned, we are very happy that even last year, the you know, the government of Telangana has been extremely progressive. They invited IDF to write a proposal to invite the World Design Organization to hold their annual general meeting at Hyderabad. We wrote out the entire proposal for them, and also the Hyderabad Design Week. And it was a very interesting experience because we worked on it for more than 12 months. And we were competing, the finalists for the World Design Organization's AGM were Beijing. And you can imagine how much of a red carpet Beijing threw out.
Yeah.
And also the amount of money that China was willing to spend to get the World Design Organization to come up. So we, our proposal actually won the bid. And we hosted an enormous and highly successful Hyderabad Design Week with the WDO AGM. We had phenomenal speakers as always, because you know it's IDF. And just so you know, and your viewers know, that the World Design Organization is 170 member organizations from 40 nations around the world.
Right.
And because we brought them to India, they've now got, they've elected an Indian on the committee of the WDO, which means more projects for designers in India, more partnership. So at IDF, we view ourselves really as enablers. We're really enablers. And you know, design is really an integrated process. It's a methodology or a way of thinking, you know, which really guides the synthesis of creativity, technology, scientific and commercial disciplines to produce a unique and superior product or a service or communications. That is what design is. It's integrated. It's an integrated synthesis of all the above. You can't say design is about luxury, design is about textiles, or design is about just architecture. It's not. Design is a way of thinking, and it's an integration. And that's why I say the word synthesis of all these creative manifestations.
True, and I think when you curate the forums, I've noticed you've managed to, you know, you always get one from each segment, which is so nice because each person gets exposure from the other, because I think it's multidisciplinary. You can't just say, I'm only this. I think today design is so fluid that you cannot box yourself anymore.
You cannot box yourself anymore. I mean, I'm interested in art. I've been called somewhat a collector. I run away from definitions because definitions limit any individual. So, you know, I think, and you know, I love architecture. I've designed every building that I've built for myself, for friends, for the factories, and you know, everything I've designed. Wow. And, you know, I love, you know, making things. I've made a lot of things, again, you know, working with carpenters and welders and so on. So I think, you know, I mean, creativity should not be defined. Creativity is a fluid experience. Yes, I'm an architect, I don't know anything about art, or I'm an artist and I cannot understand architecture. No. Please, creativity is very holistic, and we have to open our minds. You know, we have to study all of this. We have to use our eyes. We have to see, we have to go away from judgments, and India has just so much. The problem is, we haven't yet understood our own creative legacy. And we think it's fashionable to just get inspiration from the West.
True.
It's okay. The West, I'm not saying you should get inspiration from everywhere, but we have a strong design imprint on us, and it's been very craft based.
True.
So how do you take craft in and use design as an intervention to do something that is completely an Indian design language?
You know, it's really strange that you're talking about this, because this seems to have become like the overarching topic this whole week. I think anyone who's come has, we've all spoken about, given the current situation that we're in. But having said that, I agree with you that it should not be only, your inspiration should not just be India-based. Because at the end of the day, we are living on a global platform. Do you agree with me on that as well?
We are a global platform. We need to be marketing. Today we are one world.
Exactly.
We are one world. But what is our USP? How can you be different? Can you be an Italian designer? And you need to, can you be, you know, you're Indian.
Exactly. So that's where we have to.
So So let's be proud of our Indian ethos. Let's be proud of being Indian. I mean, we have so much. I mean, you know, why don't we translate that into a contemporary, utilitarian product? Why don't we do that? And lots of people are doing that. I mean, I'm happy to see a lot of the younger, contemporary Indian designers making mark in product design, in fashion design, and, you know, in architecture all over the world. I mean, that's another thing we do when I curate India Design Forum programming. I'm always looking for Indians who've studied in India, who have gone and made international names for themselves. And I can name you, Nipa Doshi. Amazing.
The names, yeah.
Okay, Satyendra Pukale, amazing. And also look at people who are working with our karigars in India, the international designers, Tom Dixon, Christian Louboutin, who makes his embroidery shoe.
I know. I know. It's all out of either. This is the same conversation I was having with Ashish as well on Monday when we were talking. You know, I briefed you about how we were talking about the India Design Forum. Sorry, the India Design Fund. And how he wants to also use that as a platform for designers to access craftsmanship as well. So if you want to create a product with a certain type of craft, you can approach them as well. You know, so essentially, I think the whole thing is to create collaboration, because I think without collaboration, there's nothing. That's how we innovate. And I think we're all on the same page with the same topic about contemporary India, handcrafted India, made in India. We're all on the same page in that sense.
It's a very exciting time. It's a very exciting time. Look at the maker spaces that have come up. Even in the times of COVID, you know, I'm watching what Makers Asylum is doing, making these products for the visors, the protection, everywhere, you know. And that is amazing. I mean, we're a great country and I'm so proud how we've lived up to it in times of these very challenging times when most nations are collapsing under the weight of COVID. And I must say that now is the time to really think about designing for the age of frugality. This designing for the age of frugality, I'd like to emphasize on, because the world is moving to less waste, more consciousness to the environment.
Less and lean.
You know, we can stretch our resources, our natural resources, our artificial resources, our money, all of it, we can stretch. And it's not alien to us.
So I completely agree with you, and I love how you've coined it, the age of frugality. I think that's something that's a huge takeaway from this conversation.
I feel very conscious. This earth, we've destroyed ourselves for decades with opulence, with insensitivity, and look what we've got. So we have to be conscious, you know, give more back. And design, as I said, is a change maker.
Right.
And also for India, there's another very big question. The whole era of artificial intelligence.
Exactly.
You know, with the millions of livelihoods at stake in India, how do we use artificial intelligence not to replace or displace people? How can we think as designers? How can we think as thinkers? You know, how can we use the strength of this country, the strength of the creativity and the innovative spirit of this country, to get into the age of artificial intelligence without losing people and without people losing jobs? How do we do this? How do we deploy our people in a more productive way? These are questions for designers. I'm sorry, you know, we should not be consumed by luxury. In a country like ours, we have no right to be consumed by luxury.
I agree with you. And on that note, Rajshri, I'm going to end with two things that everyone needs to think about. The age of frugality, designing for the age of frugality. I think that's a huge takeaway. And as you said, to keep artificial intelligence in mind. Again, how do we think ahead? What is the future? How do we incorporate that? Thank you so much, Rajshri. And I'm going to move on to a lighter note, which is our rapid fire before we end. So I hope you're ready for that. It's just 10 short quick questions. And I'm going to let me know when you're ready, and then I'm going to start. Okay.
Sure, I'm always ready.
Always ready. Okay, let's do it. Three words to describe good design.
Aesthetics, utility, and sensitivity.
All right. Black or white?
White.
The Tate or MoMA?
Do I have to choose?
You have to choose one.
MoMA.
A design or an art book that you keep going back to? this is the London, which one is this?
You got.
Oh, okay, fine. Sabyasachi or Christian Louboutin? You have to choose once again.
Louboutin because.
Okay.
He also uses India, uses Indian tradition.
It's a rapid fire. You don't need to choose Louboutin. What would you rather splurge on? A Banksy or a Raza?
Raza!
The most overused word in the world of design. The most overused word in the world of design.
Give me a minute. The most overused word in the world of design.
Or art world. Any overused word could be art world also.
Create.
Okay. A design trend that should have never come around.
A design trend that
should have never come around, that you don't like, or you know, you don't know how it became popular.
Plastic.
Good one. If you could have dinner with any architect, designer, or an artist, dead, alive, who would you pick?
Okay, design, architect, or okay. For me, Frank Lloyd Wright.
An art piece that caught you spellbound instantly.
Raza's Encounter.
The most incredible movie set design for you.
I can't hear you.
The most incredible movie set design.
Okay. Mad Max.
And last one, your favorite design store.
I have so many.
It could be online, it could be anything. It could be in...
I think it would be the Arum store in London.
Okay, got it. The Arum store in London, all right.
A-R-A-M, yeah.
Yes. Brilliant, Raj, you've done very well on a rapid fire, especially where you have to choose between Sabyasachi and Louboutin. I could see Sophie's choice happening over there.
You got me there. I love Sabya as well, and I hope he's not seeing this.
But anyway, thank you so much, Rachi, and thank you for giving us India Design Forum. I think for all of us, it's been a huge inspiration and a huge starting point for design. So anyone who's watching, please go to their handles. They have amazing videos. We've collaborated with India Forum as well to showcase some exclusive speakers. We started with Tim Kobe, who is outstanding. He's designed the Apple stores. So keep watching and keep following India Design Forum. And Rajshree, anything you want to add about design and design thinking?
Well, I think we need to continue thinking and not be caught up with just making yes. mindlessly. So let's think before we make. I think that's very important. And Design Pataki doing a great job. Keep it going. We need you. IDF, we believe in inclusivity. We believe in partnerships. And that's the only way you can spread the message. And we're all about spreading the message. And making a change.
I could not agree with you more. It's all about collaborations. It's all about supporting each other. And I think that's what connects both of us, is that we are mentally well aligned in the same thought process, which I think is great. So everyone watching, please watch more, learn more. And, you know, I think that's the way forward. And the age of frugality, that's something I'm going to be thinking about today.
And thank you, Isha, for coming to every single IDF. Thank you.
Thank
keep
you.
Keep it going. Thank you.
Bye. Bye. Have a super day.
See everyone, you. Keep sane and safe.
Bye, take care.
Bye. Take care. Bye.